In this documentary, the King James Version of the Bible will be used to present all scripture reference. We at Israelite Heritage use the true names of the Father and Son, which are Yah and Yahushua. Yah is the proper name of the Most High, and Yahushua is the proper name of His Son.
Israelite Heritage does not support any racial superiority doctrine.
They're all going to be in prison, or dead, one of the two.
Blacks represent 1 in 8 Americans, yet they account for 1 out of 2 people living with HIV/AIDS.
Shows St. Petersburg police officers handcuffing and arresting a 5-year-old girl.
It has been a long ride for our people in the lands of the Americas. For nearly 400 years, so-called black people have suffered at the hands of the wicked oppressors. Our knowledge of our ancient past has been hidden away from us. How did this happen? What events in our history allowed this to take place? In the present, the so-called black man and woman is suffering from a serious identity crisis. This crisis has made us confused about who we are, who our Creator is, and what our purpose as a people is. It was once said that a people without a history or the knowledge of their history is a people that does not exist. Our people are the owners of a unique history that stretches back thousands of years. This history has been purposely kept a secret. Have you ever wondered why? We are the only people who were forbidden to practice our original culture upon arriving to this land. Have you ever wondered why they made it against the law for us to sing Negro spiritual songs that talked about the Old Testament?
Let my people go, oppressed so hard they could not stand. Let my people go, go down.
Have you ever wondered why they changed our original name? Have you ever wondered why they did not want us to read the Bible? Our entire history and identity in the Americas as part of biblical prophecy, from arriving in the bottom of slave ships to lynchings, Jim Crow, discrimination, disease-stricken, police brutality, high prison population, etc. All this can be found in the Bible as part of the curses. The biblical Israelites made a contract or covenant with Yah, the Most High. A covenant, by definition, is an agreement. It is usually formal between two or more persons to do or not to do something specified.
The book of Exodus, chapter 19, verses 5. Now, therefore, if you will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all the people, for all the earth is mine. The book of Exodus, chapter 19, verses 8. And all the people answered together and said, all that Yah hath spoken, we will do. And Moses returned the words of the people unto Yah.
Well, the covenants are most important to the nation of Israel because it is the foundation of our relationship with Yah the Most High. It is through the covenants that we have this perpetual relationship with Yah that will last forever. Now, when Yah made this covenant, now remember that a covenant is a contract made between two parties. Now, two parties come together and they agree to fulfill a certain duty within this contract or this covenant. So when two people get married, that's why we take the marriage vow. And you tell your spouse that I'm going to do this for you, I'm going to love you, I'm going to cherish you forever to death do us part. So whenever you make this covenant, you are taking this vow. So Yah the Most High vowed to his people, the nation of Israel, that he would make us the mightiest righteous nation on the planet.
Within the context of the covenant, Yah tells us to obey his word, which is his law. The word of the Most High was delivered into the hands of the Israelite nations. We are given the charge of spreading the full truth.
The book of Exodus, chapter 24, verses 8. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which Yah had made with you concerning all these words.
The reason why our forefathers came to this country. You all know the reason why?
Besides being taken here?
Yeah. Well, I'm going to tell you the reason why. I'm going to make it real quick, though. Our forefathers, which were the children of Israel, they made a covenant with the Most High. And in that covenant with the Most High that they made, they said that they would obey all his laws and his statutes and his commandments. And we as a nation didn't do that. And this is why we are cursed as a nation of people right now. This is why you see all those brothers and sisters hanging out on the street corners and stuff like that. You know what I'm saying? Going buck wild. The Bible prophesied that was being in this country thousands of years before we even made it here. But I'm just want to get you know this truth out here about who we are as a nation because they have taken that from us, man. They have taken our identity from us. And we gotta find our identity again. And it starts out with this, you know what I'm saying? This, hey, brothers, we headed for some serious times. We cursed as a nation. This is why we got the high blood pressure, AIDS, from every disease it is. You know, this is why we're going through what we're going through, because of the curse.
We, the children of Israel, told Yah through the mouth of Yah's prophet Moses, because we were so terrified of seeing Yah, that we said, Moses, you go and you speak to him and you tell him that everything that he said we shall do as a people.
In the Bible, in the scriptures, Yah made this covenant with a specific group of people. And he said, as covenants go, if you do this, I will do this. Period. And if you relate the fact that we read in the scriptures, those covenants were broken, they were not followed. And therefore, just like parents do, you know, when you say, well, I told you if you did that, I was going to punish you like this. God should be doing the same thing.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 8, verses 5. And you shall also consider in your heart that as a man chastens his son, so Yah chastens you.
So when we made this covenant in Exodus chapter 19, Exodus chapter 24, and Yah bound that covenant to us, he said, okay, children of Israel, you're going to be my people, and all I require of you is for you to be a nation of priests, take my word to all the sons of Adam, get them to repent and turn from their sins. This is our calling, this is our duty.
The book of Exodus, chapter 19, verses 6. And you shall be unto me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words which you shall speak unto the children of Israel.
We are being whipped by the hand of the Most High. Our oppressors and our enemies are nothing more than a belt in his hand. He is doing this to correct us, to get us to come back to him in righteousness, so that we may fulfill our end of the covenant. Our time has come. The last wind of the curses is coming to a close. By the end of our punishment, we will be the people he chose us to be. Bible prophecy tells us the children of Israel will lose the knowledge of who they really are. This is also part of our punishment for disobeying the Most High. Since our arrival in the United States in the year 1619, we have been called by many different names in place of our true name. As a collective people, we don't know what our true nationality is. Nationality refers to belonging to a nation of people. When you know your nationality, you know your history and heritage. The United States is comprised of people from all around the world. Every person living in the United States can point to their country of origin, which represents their nationality.
My name is Ken. I'm Irish and Polish.
My name is Michael Krause. I'm German and Polish.
My name is Abdullah Sambala. I'm interested from Indonesia, but I was born and raised in Saudi Arabia.
My name is Sam and I'm
My name is Raku. I'm from India, and I'm Indian.
I'm Veer Vidala. I'm from Edmonton also, and I'm Indian.
I'm Tony Rogers, and I'm kind of a mutt. I have everything in me, so I'm not really one specific thing.
What ones do you remember?
Just like English, Irish, Scottish, Indian.
The so-called African-American cannot name his true homeland.
My name is Carla Buford, and I'm African-American.
Okay, I'm Carlani Hamsey, and I'm Black.
All right, thank you.
All right.
Brazilian?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I'm Kylie Blanco. I am Puerto Rican.
Jordan March, Brooklyn, Texas, African-American.
Nathan Guadalupe, Washington, D.C. I'm Ronald Kay, and I'm African-American.
Hello, I'm Damian Jordan. I'm from America. I'm a freshman here at OU, and I'm African-American.
What is your nationality?
African-American. How they gonna name you after two continents? African-American. You know, that's two continents.
Yeah, it is.
You know what I'm saying? How they gonna name you after two continents?
Do you know what African-American means?
Basically, slave.
Yeah, that's somewhat true. Don't you know America was named after Amerigo Vespucci?
Oh, no. Everybody else know where they come from but us.
Right, right.
You know what I'm saying?
Either they met from Mexico or somewhere else.
Yeah. Man. If you're from China, you're from, if you're Chinese, you're from China. If you're from Germany, if you're German, you're from Germany. You know what I'm saying? But we called African-Americans.
African-Americans.
All I know is my ancestors, all that was born here. And we just raised out here in California. They don't want us to know who we are as a nation, man. The world was split up into nations. The world was split up into nations. We're a nation of people. Our heritage has been forgotten.
Why is it that we don't have any information about our heritage at all? Why are we so short-term memory? Why we don't have a heritage as so-called black people?
I believe that the white man destroyed all our papers and all that.
What if I told you that we do have a history book, and you probably been looking at it all along, but you never knew?
They do. I like to get that book.
It's called the Bible.
Oh, yeah.
That's our history book.
We are the children of Israel, and all praises go to God.
Isaiah chapter 1, verses 2 through 3. Hear, O heavens, and give ear, O earth. For Yah hath spoken, I have nourished and brought up the children, and they have rebelled against me. Verses 3. The ox knows his owner, and the donkey his master's crib, but Israel does not know. My people do not consider.
Another thing we have to realize as far as the lost identity of Israel is the separation within the nation itself that this world has brought about, or that Satan has brought about. Throughout the transatlantic slave trade, you had Israelite slaves being parceled out all over the world. And now what you have today, you have people who are all Israelites, but they think they're separated by these nations that they just become a part of. Puerto Ricans, Dominicans, Cubans, all this, these are descendants of Israelite slaves. We're all from the same nation of people.
A nation's heritage is comprised of their history and nationality.
For the true identity of the so-called African-American, so-called Haitian, Jamaican, Puerto Rican, Cuban, Dominican, all those people that were brought here in the transatlantic slave trade into the Western Hemisphere, our true identity is that we are the children of Israel. We are those Israelites that are mentioned from the book of Genesis to the book of Revelation. See, the game that has been played on us, and this is even prophecy as it goes into how we lost our identity, is this. Our slave masters devised an elaborate scheme. In this scheme, they devised a plan that would keep us docile, that would keep us ignorant of the truth of who we are for centuries.
You look at my skin and you would think that I'm an ethnicity of Puerto Rico, but I'm not Puerto Rican. According to scriptures, I'm Hebrew. My ancestors come from the Atlantic, that were affected by the Atlantic slave. But if you look, they separated, they made a division with black and Puerto Ricans, are two different people, but if you look at it, black and Puerto Ricans can't even stay away from each other. We're the same people because we, no matter what, how separate they try to make us, we still wind up coming back together. It's just, it's you know, that's what it is. But they use that, oh, well, you got long fine hair versus the coarse hair. They use all of our attributes to turn us against one another, not realizing that we are the same people.
We have been separated from our land,
let me hear you say
culture, history, and heritage. Yah allowed this to be done by the hand of our enemies. There has been a conspiracy in operation for a very long time. A conspiracy to wipe our minds clean of our identity.
The Book of Psalms, chapter 83, verses 1 through 4. Keep not your silence, O Yah, hold not your peace, and be not still, O Yah. Verses 2. For lo, your enemies make a tumult, and they that hate you have lifted up the head. Verse 3. They have taken crafty counsel against your people, and consulted against your hidden ones. Verse 4. They have said, come, let's cut them off from being a nation, so that the name of Israel be no more in remembrance.
The way that the children of Israel lost their identity, Psalms 83, 1-4 kind of describes that. It says that crafty counsel was taken against the children of Israel. And crafty counsel means that
actually fight. They actually plan. They actually sat around and devised a plan to make Israel the name, the nationality of the people, be no more. And that fits us exactly, because I see no other people on the planet that identity is lost. But ours, we are the only people on the planet that don't know
William Lynch was a slave owner in the West Indies who devised a plan in 1712 that he said would keep the Hebrew slaves in a passive, ignorant state for 300 years. The following is an excerpt from the infamous Willie Lynch letter. Our experts warned us about the possibility of this phenomenon occurring, for they say that the mind has a strong drive to correct and recorrect itself over a period of time if it can touch some substantial original historical base. And they advised us that the best way to deal with this phenomenon is to shave off the brute's mental history and create a multiplicity of phenomena of illusions. The Willie Lynch Letter.
The Willie Lynch Letter. This slave owner from the West Indies wrote to other slave owners in the Americas. Now, other people say, well, this was something that was not true. This was a made-up letter. But we look at what the letter says, and we look at what it contains, and we know that this process have been put upon our people, so we know that what's written in the Willie Lynch Letter is, in fact, true.
And if you take a look at the Willie Lynch Letter and do any type of research on it, he wasn't the only slave owner. This whole address of Willie Lynch was for other slave owners to practice this also, and you'll find the words that he wrote and spoke. He was saying that we have to keep these slaves from touching any historical base of their true culture and identity, and create abundance of delusions to keep us blind, so that we have no interest in even researching who we are. Because if so, the mind can recorrect itself, and therefore you will no longer be the spiritual and mental slave as we have so many people today within the Israelite nation.
Willie Lynch put in place, when you read the making of a slave, how he did it, his plan has been executed. We have, if you look at everything that he written in that book, has been manifested. They put the light-skinned black versus the dark-skinned black.
Everybody on the planet have a country. They have a country they're from, and they have a nationality within that country. But we are called African Americans, and actually that's two continents. That's, you know, the North American continent and the continent of Africa.
So what are we?
We're Americans. We are in America. We're born in America. Our birth certificate is from American society. That means that we are citizens of America, so we are Americans.
I don't consider myself African American. No, I don't consider myself white. I don't consider myself Asian, Hispanic, Somalian, or nothing. I consider myself to be a black American. Why? Because I was born in America. My mother was born in America. My dad was born in America. And their parents was born in America. You know, and their parents was born in America, you know.
You are the one who are brainwashed because you believe that you're an American. You believe that you're an African American. You believe that you're black. You call yourselves bywords and proverbs. You affectionately call yourself a nigger, but you get upset when someone else calls you a nigger. How stupid is that?
America is a continent with separated into three parts, North, Central, and South. So you say, I am an American, which only means that you live on the continent of America. People in Mexico are Americans. Canadians are Americans. People who live in South America are Americans because they live on the continent of America. But yet, when we talk about the nationality, which relates to a country, who are you? Who are you? Where did you come from? Africa is a once again continent. What country in Africa can you claim and that will claim you?
Jeremiah chapter 17 verses 4. And you, even yourself, shall discontinue from your heritage that I gave you, cause you to serve your enemies in the land which you do not know. For you have kindled a fire in my anger, which shall burn forever.
Because of the punishment we're under, the children of Israel won't have knowledge of who they really are.
There's a strange fruit hanging from the trees, but not the kind of Billie Holiday's days with blood all on the leaves. But these are a different set of trees, and they bear a strange fruit called ignorance, with an illusion at the sleeve. An illusion so thick, sometimes it's hard to breathe. But who will hearken to Yah's fresh air? Who would all believe? I feel like I am in the days of Martin Luther King, back when black folks marched and sang songs and Martin had a dream. But what exactly was his dream? I found myself asking myself over and over these things, what exactly was his dream? I thought, and so my thoughts led me to February 1818. He was born Frederick Douglass, a man who also had this dream. To not have to work the cotton fields courtesy of the curses was his dream. See, to not be so dark, so black, this was his dream. And in 1845, he found himself on the winning team. Tired of hearing screams of being slapped up, he slipped up into a secret society. Wanted to be a part of this world so badly, he joined the American Anti-Slavery Society. Mistakenly joining a secret society determined to turn him away from his own society. This was his conclusion. Mr. Douglass, my friends kind of caught up in this illusion.
Part of the covenant promises Yah made to the children of Israel was that they would own their own land. He promised to give us a very good land, flowing with milk and honey. It would be ours forever. There is just one problem. In order to keep this blessing, we as a people must keep our end of the covenant and obey Yah's voice. Yah warned us that if we didn't obey and listen to him, that we would be exiled from the land he gave us.
The book of Genesis, chapter 15, verses 13. And he said unto Abram, Know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in the land that is not theirs, and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years.
Okay, now, here's the understanding here. Genesis 15:13, very important scripture here. It lays it out. In fact, Genesis 15:13 and verse 14, this is what it says. Yah is speaking to his prophet Abraham. This is Father Abraham, who is the father of the Hebrew Israelite nation. Yah says, Abraham, know for certain. Now, when Yah tells you to know something for certain, he's telling you this. Know for sure that what I'm about to say here is going to happen. Abraham, know for certain that your seed shall be sojourners or strangers in a land that is not theirs, Abraham, and they shall be afflicted evil. They shall serve these people, and they shall be afflicted evil for a period of 400 years. The so-called African American came into the North America in 1619. He was brought here as a servant, and then he was made into a slave. Now the prophecy, remember the prophecy stated that we shall serve these people and we shall be afflicted for 400 years. So since we have stepped off those slave ships in 1619, if you look at our history in this land, from slavery to discrimination to Jim Crow to police brutality to everything that we're suffering as a people, it has been one continuous stomping, meaning that there has not been a let up, and it's been nearly 400 years. Yah said that we should be mistreated or treated evil by these people for 400 years. Abraham's seed will be a stranger in a place that is not theirs, in a land that is not theirs. The United States is not ours.
Made racial slavery to southern slaveholders much more attractive, because what were black slaves now? Well, they were a permanent, dependent labor force who could be defined as a people set apart. They were racially set apart. They were outsiders. They were strangers. And in many ways throughout the world, with a couple possible exceptions, slavery has taken root especially well when the people who are enslaved are defined as strangers, as outsiders, and can therefore be put into an inheritable, permanent status of slavery.
Jamestown, Virginia was founded in 1607, and she just celebrated her 400-year anniversary in 2007. It was a big hoopla about it. The Queen of England was here to celebrate it, so forth and so on. And then in 1619, which is 12 years later from 1607, she had members of the 12 tribes of Israel, the 12 tribes of Israel, brought into her ports as servants to begin the fulfillment of the prophecy written in Genesis chapter 15, verse 13.
400 years ago this month, three small ships arrived on these shores. As the community grew, Africans were brought here. It was the origin of American slavery that would take so many generations to overcome. A painful history, at least noted.
The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verses 36. Yah shall bring thee, and thy king which thou shalt set over thee, unto a nation which neither thou nor thy fathers have known, and there shalt thou serve other gods, wood and stone. The book of Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verses 64. And Yah shall scatter thee among all the people, from the one end of the earth even unto the other, and there you shall serve gods which neither you nor thy fathers have known, even wood and stone.
The true Israelites have been scattered from east to west, north to south. There probably isn't a country on earth that doesn't have a percentage of Israelites in their population. Black people are very spiritual. It's an old saying, but it's true. We can be found in just about all religions on the earth, from Jim Jones.
Man, it hurts just to see my people following men. Back then, I was lost, trapped, following sin. Drowned out my pain with a whole bottle of gin. Of course, the number had me moving like a Porsche. Boxed in like
to David Koresh.
Lost the control of the wheel and went off the track. Now my back, so Satan, get off the service that's speaking the truth. I let my pen bleed on paper, then I speak the truth. Right?
And everything in between, we have been and are a part of.
But they won't, because they rather just wait on the tide that are drowned in it change when it all subside.
The Apostle Shaul, aka Paul, said, Israel has a zeal for the Most High, but not according to knowledge.
The book of Romans, chapter 10, verses 1 through 2. Brethren, my heart's desire and prayer to Yah is for Israel, that they may be saved. Verse 2. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of Yah, but not according to knowledge.
The prophecy said we would serve false gods that neither we nor our forefathers knew. Our ancient forefathers didn't know about these gods, religions that Israel is serving today. They didn't know about Jesus, the Christian, Christ, Allah, Buddha, Krishna, Voodoo, New Age, and many of these gods are actually wood and stone gods.
All opponents are clowns. Blood in the world of truth until the system drowns. When the Most High is with us, we amaze and astound. Still the essence of the old team, time in the ground. Stomp the streets of deep town, and I'm heaping down. Raise hanging tassels, swinging, no smiles or frowns. The world is raw, you'll break if you're brittle. A cesspool of sin where attitudes are uncivil. And government officials lie more than a little. Hypocrites speaking riddles, keep the world on the swivel. For sure they did that, it ain't no get back. Hot flows, we spit that, refrain from being lax. Cause the beast will attack, exact. Made flats, spit facts, blaze tracks. These raps are combat. Bringing in CJ hats, lock them up on the mat. Apply pressure.
nations and we making them tell. For the coming times of cataclysmic, it's deeper than gas, deeper than cars and clothes, and that garbage is whack. These fools will sell their souls, laying down on their backs, getting used and abused and thrown out to the rats. And these preachers steady scheming for scraps and stacks. We on the brink of judgment day and he ain't teaching me jack. These adversaries wicked, planting seeds of strife. It's best to check their history on the stars and stripes. And how we got here, the message is so clear. Yet it's still Israel's, but none aware for years. So-called family members fear me and my peers, cause we constant reminders revolution is near. Courageous like David and his Yah's platoon. That's why Goliath found himself squaring off with a goon. Why you think these crooked cops stop harassing beaters? Why you think we on the block getting thrashed with heaters? Or why they let us rot in the aftermath of Katrina? Or why they tossed us all on ships with no man to redeem us? Why you think we so obsessed with money, feelings, and demons? It's all in the lines of scripture, we ain't reading between them. Too focused on false pictures, led astray by these demons. Getting our minds since the drift, still American dreaming. We gotta find this uplift to make them feel what we're speaking. But every second in this wicked world, treason and season. So I'm creeping like Shinobi, so emergence of the serpent. Cause it's been a short answer if your mind is in that burden. What's the stain for this war? So I hear a lot of talk.
Book of Luke, chapter 21, verses 22 through 23. For these be the days of vengeance, that all things which are written may be fulfilled. Verse 23. But woe unto them that are with child, and to them that give suck, in those days, for there shall be great distress in the land, and wrath upon this people. Verse 24. And they shall fall by the edge of the sword, and shall be led away captive unto all nations. And Jerusalem shall be trodden down by the Gentiles until the times of the Gentiles be fulfilled.
Okay, when we look into scripture and we read about these people called the Gentiles, when we see this word Gentile, what is that exactly? Well, Gentile comes from the Hebrew word goy, G-O-Y, and it means nation. The plural of goy or nations is G-O-Y-I-M, goyim. These are Hebrew words. Now these Hebrew words, this English word Gentile comes from these Hebrew words goy and goyim, and it means nation, G-O-Y, goy, Gentile, or nations, plural, goyim, G-O-Y-I-M, or Gentiles. So the children of Israel applied this title Gentiles to the Europeans who lived north of them, who are the descendants of Noah's son Japheth. The Hebrews knew that there were people living north of them, but they were not familiar with these people nationalities. They didn't know a Greek from a Roman, from a Goth or whoever. They just knew that there were nations of people living up there. So we applied the name Gentiles for the nations. See, when you read scripture, you will see that they were familiar with the people who were surrounding them. The Ethiopians, the Babylonians, the Egyptians, the Hittites and the Canaanites and all these people, because these people were, nations that surrounded the children of Israel. So we knew them by their national name, but the people called, up in Europe, the Gentiles, we just placed that name on them. It was just a generic term that we placed upon them because we were not familiar with them.
In 70 CE, the Roman Emperor Vespasian and his general son Titus came against Jerusalem and destroyed it. The majority of the Israelites in Jerusalem were killed or taken as captives, while others escaped into Africa. This is the wrath upon Israel that was mentioned in verse 23.
The Romans attacked from the north and we ran south, down into Africa, into Egypt, into Ethiopia.
The Hebrews that were taken captive were sold throughout the Mediterranean world as slaves This is the beginning of the Hebrews being led captive into all nations, as it is written in verse 24. Right.
Now, as we, those who had escaped, we build communities in those areas, in Ethiopia, in Egypt, and along the eastern coast of Africa. And then in the 7th century, here comes Islam, and here comes Muhammad. And Muhammad started converting our people to Islam by the sword.
And Hebrews were led captive into all Arab countries, Arabia, so-called Mideast, and North Africa. Arab slavery started 1,000 years before the European slave trade. The Muslims were the first to inform the Portuguese of the people of the book. This is a title that Muslim gave the Israelites of West and East Africa.
The success of Muhammadan Islam in deceiving, misinforming, deforming, and contorting both history and reality over a period of almost 1400 years has been astounding. That is, until now. The greatest tragedy about this particular subject is that most of the descendants of African slavery, the black people in the Americas, around the world, as well as among the African blacks, are totally ignorant of the actual facts. Before we lose the concentration of our listeners, I would like to make the following statement and then prove it. That the worst, most inhumane and most diabolical institution of the black African slave trade was initiated, refined, perpetrated and implemented by the Muhammadan Arabs and later aided and abetted by the black converts to Muhammadan Islam. I predict that as usual, the two subcultures, those of denial of facts and of political correctness, will attack us without once disproving a single statement and or conclusion that we make.
Now the Messiah said that we shall be spread into all nations, right? So we were spread into the Arab world, the so-called Mideast, by the hands of the Arab, and then we were taken into the European world on the west coast of Africa by the hands of the Europeans. And so this prophecy, Luke 21:24, was fulfilled with the children of Israel. And that's why when we look at the Western Hemisphere captivity that we're under right now, we were not spread into just one nation. We did not just come into the United States. We did not just come into Brazil. We did not just come into Jamaica. We came into every land of this hemisphere as captives. And this is exactly what the Messiah said was going to happen to the children of Israel. This too is part of the curses of going into captivity. And as you see, there's no other people that can produce documents to say that their people was taken worldwide into captivity.
Isaiah chapter 5 verses 13. Therefore, my people are going into captivity because they have no knowledge, and their honorable men are famished, and their multitude dried up with thirst.
Okay, well, we as a people, the nation of Israel, have gone into so many captivities because of the lack of knowledge. We don't have knowledge of who we are, who Yah is, what covenants we made with them. From the ancient times, we were first taken into captivity by Egypt, and then we were taken by Assyria, Babylon, you know, Persia, the Romans, the Greeks, and now we come to the Americas.
Just about every nation on earth had a hand in this slave trade. The Portuguese, Dutch, Spanish, French, British, Jews, the U.S., Muslims, Christians, both Protestant and Catholics, Italians, Danes, Swedes, Russians, and even all five of the so-called civilized American Indian tribes.
discrimination, racism, police brutality, lynchings, poverty, ghettos. Slavery and oppression plays a big role in the curses that were put upon us for our disobedience to Yah Almighty.
Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 16. Cursed shall thou be in the city, and cursed shall thou be in the field.
The majority of the so-called African Americans live in the inner city of the United States. These inner cities are referred to as ghettos or slums. The condition in many of the ghettos are so bad that they easily could be mistaken for any war-torn country. Drugs, gangs, and poverty dominate the landscape of the major cities in the United States. The Hebrew side of town is always the worst part of the city, whether in the country or the city. The curses are sure to follow.
It's your boy,
yeah,
it's Kiya.
It's just like hell to Tanisha. Take me to walk in my hood
and show you how the curses all over my people, man.
Come on home with me, where the blocks are messed up. Crack streets, cops are messed up. Crack fiends, cops arrest us. No probable cause, many like to test us. Come home with me, where people look like each other. Though they don't care, man, they fight each other. Over bright G colors, Crips and Bloods, yo, they smite each other. Over flags, they don't like each other. Come on home with me.
The store right here?
Yeah.
This is the store where they used to sell cocaine out the back of it. I never used to see Gentiles when I was a little kid, but when you see Gentiles, you know something bad happening if they're not cops. You know, like, many people got gunned down in there, and this store has been condemned for over 15 years. They cannot even open it up because people keep getting killed in there. So, son.
Hey, man, right across the street right here is another one.
Some people I know that got killed on this avenue right here, these three blocks, Kirk Avenue.
Last night was violent all over the city. 20 people were shot in just 12 hours, and at least 3 people are dead. 3 teenagers were shot near 70th and Wood. One of the teens is in critical condition at this hour. The conditions of the other two still not known. And at least 14 other people were shot elsewhere in the city.
Come on home with me. Well, we can get garbage for cheap. We don't care, cause that's all we eat. Chinese food everywhere, as far as the eyes can see. Chinese, it's all about greed. Come on home with me. So where the doors hang over hinges. Drunk parents, man, they hang over bridges. Kids scattered around. Look at you like this ain't your business. No wonder why I hang on my fringes. Come on home with me. With Sean Bell got killed.
And how long have you been living here in New York?
New York. 15 years, but I was born and raised in Chicago. Well, I was living with my grandmother.
Right.
She passed away, so I wasn't on the lease.
Right.
So I had to be on the lease, so I had to leave.
Right.
And then 4 months later, I lost a leg.
Okay.
So, I mean, bullcrap, stuff like that.
Right.
You know, I used a leg. You know how you use a leg and people treat you differently.
Right.
Things like that, especially when you got a whole lot of family here.
Okay.
All my family is from Chi-Town and from Savannah, Georgia.
Savannah, Georgia?
Yeah.
Man, so why wouldn't you go back to the city? Not saying that things will be better, but you just...
My people, yeah, I lost my leg.
Uh-huh.
They don't want to put up.
Okay, I get you.
I can't go there if they don't want me there.
Okay.
You ever... How you feel like you ain't wanted, so...
Oh, yeah, definitely. You ever, and speaking of that, do you ever get harassed by, like, the police around here?
All the time.
All the time?
All the time.
Well, what do they say when you tell them that you ain't got nowhere to go?
Ain't they business.
Do you know why we're in the situations that we are in?
Because we're black, for one.
Uh-huh.
And for two, what I know is, they made it like that. Just... Stay together, man. Have love. 40 people.
and something like this happens, don't change color. You know? Just love your kind, B. And don't change, B. That's all. You keep your heart and keep what you're doing. You keep love for everybody. You know? As long as we love you, B. All
right. Thank you.
Well, I'm a security guard. I mean, I work in a homeless shelter.
Hmm. What group of people do you mostly work with?
Hebrews. It's not like a movie, because you know you see movies with Gentile security guards. It's kind of like a fantasy, because I've never seen that in my life. It's really Israelites. That's, most of them are Israelites that I work with. Maybe just one or two that are not. But for the most part, it's just all Hebrews. So-called blacks, you know, so-called Latinos, like Puerto Ricans and Dominicans.
What group of people do you see most as your job environment, as far as residents and, you know, kids and stuff like that?
If I give a percentage, I'm going to say 98% Hebrews.
Wow.
98%. It's a family shelter that I work in, and there's a whole bunch of little kids there, too, so that's what really gets me, like, little kids having to go out their room just to go to a bathroom. Along with a whole bunch of grown men and women. You know, that's just not a place for a child to be.
And speaking of that, can you describe some of the conditions at this homeless shelter? Because I know you showed me pictures. It's ridiculous, their conditions there.
Oh, man, like, the conditions in that shelter is pure. It's just, like, ridiculous, man. Like, I've seen roaches, rats. I mean, there are many times where I would just be standing somewhere and a roach would crawl on me. I'm like, out of nowhere, you know? I've seen feces in the bathroom, like, not in the toilets, but, like, in showers. You see stuff like that, you know? Like, old rotten foods. You see, like tampons and stuff like that just laying around. You know, just, like, garbage cans being, like, filthy, piling up to the top. You know, the custodians or whatever you want to call them, the cleaners, they don't do their job. Half of the time, they sleep throughout the whole night. You know, they may pick up a couple of things here and there, but for the most part, that place is filthy. Like, the floors are never swept. They don't mop the floor unless some important city agency or somebody important from the city comes and checks out the place. And then even that, they only clean the first floor when people enter, but they never go upstairs.
Mm-hmm.
There was one time, this female, it was in the summer, she came with her little son. Her son was about a year or two old. And they gave her a room. And I remember clear as day, she came and asked me, she said, come here, let me show you something. So I went to her room and looked. And I stood outside the door and I seen that the doors were boarded up with wood. And it was in the middle of summer. And there was no fan in the room. And she asked me to ask someone for a fan. And when I asked somebody for a fan, they said she has to wait until tomorrow.
Wow.
And I'm like, but her son has asthma though. So saying like, they treat our people like they're dogs. I mean, how do you board up a window with wood and you give that room to somebody that just came in with a new, like a little child, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That's what really gets me.
Tell my sweet baby, please don't.
Deuteronomy 28:25. Yah shall cause you to be smitten before your enemies. You shall go in one way against them and flee seven ways before them, and shall be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth. Smitten is defined as being afflicted or defeated. Yah is telling us in this verse that the children of Israel will be afflicted and defeated by the power and might of our enemies. The so-called black people have been afflicted by the hands of our enemies for hundreds of years. We are unable to stand against the KKK.
skinheads, neo-Nazis, and all the hate groups who come against us as a people. We are unable to stand against governmental institutions that are formed against us. These hate groups murder our people and are rarely arrested and given prison time.
And breaking news in the case of that horrific abuse story out of West Virginia. A young black woman was reportedly stabbed, choked, and sexually assaulted and beaten by a group of people for about a week. NBC's justice correspondent Pete Williams has some new information. Pete, many people had looked at this case, and because it was a young black woman and those who abused her were six white individuals, some had said there should be federal hate crime charges. Will there be those charges?
Not for now. And one of the reasons they were looking at them is it was alleged that as they were assaulting her, as they were stabbing her, for example, they were repeatedly using a racial epithet. But now, after looking at the case more closely with the state officials, the federal government has deferred any prosecution in this case, so they're going to bow out for now and leave it up to West Virginia authorities to prosecute.
Police call it a violent hate crime. A man deliberately targeted a woman because she's black.
And today, that random innocent victim is recovering in the hospital with a broken leg, broken bones, and other severe injuries.
Western reporter Claire Metz tells us the young woman was riding a bike on a sidewalk in Daytona Beach when she was run down by a man looking to harm African Americans.
Our other big story, the victim of an alleged hate crime is speaking out. She says Thomas Cosby ran her over with his car, then shouted racial slurs at her. Tarek Minor is live in Daytona Beach, and Tarek, the woman was riding her bike on a sidewalk when she was hit, right?
That's correct. The 25-year-old was riding her bicycle to the grocery store when she was struck from behind by this car. She was struck right here, and then that car, well, it ran into the house right there. Mr. Cosby, according to police, got out of the car and then proceeded to yell racial slurs at the young lady. Police charging him with a hate crime because he said that all black people should die.
I don't know if people hate me, but I don't hate them. I don't have hate in my heart for him, you know. I just wish that he didn't hate me.
Police say 25-year-old Nicadia Cato was targeted because she's black. She was run down randomly while riding her bicycle on A1A by 56-year-old Thomas Cosby of Port Orange. Police say Cosby admitted to hitting Cato on purpose with his car, calling her the N-word repeatedly after breaking the 25-year-old's leg. Witnesses say Cosby screamed emphatically, "These black people need to die. Help me kill them." I saw her on the bike and went to take her out.
I actually saw him coming towards me. I tried to move my bike as fast as I can, but it wasn't quick enough. He came straight for me. If he could target me and thought I was just because of the color of my skin, he could target anybody else. What if it wasn't me? It could have been anybody else that was just lying down or just walking. You know, if I was walking, I probably would have been dead right now.
In Texas, two white men in the town of Paris have been charged in the September dragging death of an African-American man. The body of 24-year-old Brandon McClellan was found mutilated and partially dismembered. The two suspects are accused of running him over and dragging him beneath their pickup truck.
An African-American man is suing a drilling company located off the Louisiana coast after he says co-workers hung a noose around his neck and tried to choke him.
Robert Minter says he fell asleep during a break and woke up when three of his white co-workers were, as he put it, trying to hang him.
7 feet. 7 feet. Blood on the leaves. And blood at the roots. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging. poplar trees. Pastoral scene of the gallant South. Them big bulging eyes and the twisted mouth. Scent of magnolia, clean and fresh.
Over the past 18 years, vicious police attacks against Hebrew men have increased and become more deadly. Cops are getting away with cold-blooded murder.
We about to take it back, take it back, take it back. We about to take it back, take it back, take it back. We about to take it back to chanting the drums.
Here's a very important story. It's taking place in Los Angeles. It's taking place in NOLA, New Orleans, Louisiana. And it has to do with a 22-year-old being shot 12 times in the back. This is a result of a police shooting.
The Orleans Parish Coroner says Grimes was shot 14 times, including 12 times in the back. And Grimes didn't die at the hand of common street thugs. He was shot and killed by New Orleans police officers. Laquan Wright shows us where his jaw is broken and wired shut.
The injuries, he says, from a Riviera Beach police officer.
Laquan can't talk much, but his lawyer can. Richard Ryle says Laquan, with a 3.2 GPA, a starter on the Garden High football team, could just walk into his grandfather's house when the officer pulled over and slammed Laquan to the ground face first, breaking his jaw.
A Michigan police officer suspended without pay after he was caught on tape slamming a teenager's head into a wall, knocking out the teenager's three teeth. It happened after the 16-year-old was arrested for violating rules at a transit center. There's the slam there. You'll also see the team dragged across the floor by the officer. An investigation found the officer used excessive force, but concluded that the teenager's injuries were, quote, unintentional.
In Seattle, a sheriff's deputy has pleaded not guilty to charges he assaulted a 15-year-old girl last fall. Prosecutors have released a surveillance video of the alleged assault. A warning, the pictures you're about to see are disturbing. The video shows two King County Sheriff's deputies escorting 15-year-old Malika Calhoun to a holding cell. When Deputy Paul Sheen asked the girl to remove her shoes, she's seen slipping out of her left shoe and kicking it at him. Sheen rushes into the cell, kicks the teen, and pushes her against a corner wall before flinging her to the floor by her hair. He then squats down on Calhoun and hits her twice. Deputies say the girl was, quote, real lippy, and that she had called them, quote, fat pigs. Paramedics were called after Calhoun had complained that she had difficulty breathing.
Cops out here in New York City, they've been getting too trigger happy with the gun. They have killed at least 4 or 5 people within the past few years that had no weapon at all, but they gun them down, 50 shots and 30 shots, and they reload, you know, the gun and continue shooting them like Swiss cheese. I'm like, man, they have no weapon, man, but yet you shooting them as deep, because that's all part of the curses, you know. We can't defend ourselves. We can't, you know, our enemies will rise up before us. You know, that's modern day oppression. If you don't have no weapon in your hand, or be no threat to anyone,
And these cops, the modern day police brutality is that they shoot you down. That's the modern day police brutality. They will shoot you down and kill you.
Police shot and killed an unarmed man near this New Orleans bridge.
Casimir Gaston was living on the second floor by now. The door open. It was so hot, there was no power. When he woke up, he says he came out onto this balcony and witnessed right out on the street a firing squad of police gunning down an unarmed running man.
The family says Ronald Madison and his brother were running away from a police shootout with other people on the nearby bridge. This autopsy report, verified by the New Orleans coroner, shows Ronald Madison was hit 7 times, 2 wounds in his shoulder, 5 in the back. No weapon was found on the body of the mentally retarded man.
It was captured by a passenger aboard the BART train with a cell phone who does not want to be identified. You can see Oscar Grant on his knees here talking to police. Then he is pulled down onto the ground face down. There is what seems to be a struggle. Then a second BART police officer puts his knee to Grant's neck and head. The video graphically displays what happens the moment Grant is shot. One officer pulls at his gun. He stands, unholsters the gun, and fires.
Because we are unable to stand against those who are our enemies. Verse 25 also states that we shall be removed into all the kingdoms of the earth. We were unable to protect ourselves on the west coast of Africa during the transatlantic slave trade. We couldn't stop the African, Arab, or European slave traders from deporting our people by the millions. They raided our village and took captive Israelite men and women and children and scattered us into all the kingdoms of the world. This has happened to us for over 400 years. Our enemies continue to have the upper hand over us till this very hour. Deuteronomy 28 and 37. And thou shalt become an astonishment, a proverb and a byword among all the nation whither Yah shall lead thee. Astonishment means a sad, pitiful amazement, so remarkable as to elicit disbelief. The general attitude of some black people are so disgraceful that it motivates other races to observe us with astonishment.
Some say we're African, some say we're coon.
All right, y'all. What y'all have to say to Sammy?
Fuck you, bitch. Your fat ass.
And what else?
You is big in your stomach. I'm big in my ass.
Tell her, were you fat at, Cara?
In my ass.
A byword, by definition, is an object of general reproach, often an epithet of scorn.
Some say we're ignorant, others say we're thug.
Names such as nigger, nigger, negro, coon, blackie, spade, spick, porch monkey.
As a nation, we have become a mockery to the rest of the world. I mean, people look at us with scorn. They shake their heads at us. They can't even believe the behavior that we do. You know, it's really pitiful to see us out on the corner, you know, gang banging, killing each other. It does over colors, you know, killing somebody for some shoes. I mean, that doesn't even make any sense. We've been in this country. They look at us. They say, oh,
wow, these people have been in this country for 4 centuries and they haven't built anything. Man, look at those niggas, they ain't nothing. You know, we're on the bottom of everything. Y'all said that we were going to be there because of our disobedience.
While much of America celebrated Barack Obama's inauguration, one Greenwich Village baker marked the occasion with this controversial cookie.
Drunken Negro Face.
Drunken Negro Face cookies.
I make cookies that look like drunken Negro faces.
He said to me, would you like some drunken Negro heads to go with your coffee? I didn't know what to say, and then he continued to say they're in honor of our new president.
And a traditional high school is in the middle of a racial controversy right now. A teacher used the N-word towards a student.
And what did he say specifically to you?
Sit down, nigga.
Keyshawn Chambers is a freshman at Valley High School, a Boy Scout, a football player, a member of the ROTC, an honor roll student. The teacher told him to sit down, and the teacher says that Keyshawn used the N-word first.
And I just kind of was stunned a second. Well, then get away from the door, nigga. Yes, I use nigga. I've used it. I admit it. I put the H on it to emphasize it's nigga. That, you know, nigga, nigga this, nigga, nigga please, nigga. You know, can you lend a nigga a pencil?
It's me being black for about 60 some odd years. I do feel like we always a target.
Category is people who annoy you. Audience, keep quiet, please.
Niggers.
No, dude, no.
The laughing stopped abruptly Friday night at the Laugh Factory in Los Angeles when renowned actor and stand-up comic Michael Richards, best known as Kramer from Seinfeld, veered from his act and allegedly spewed the N-word at audience members in an expletive-laden tirade.
Shut up! 50 years ago, you had your own tied down with a fucking fork up your ass!
Oh my God.
A nigger, look, there's a nigger!
Ooh. Ooh.
They arrest me for calling a black man a nigger.
It's about esteem, and that's why we are urging people to stop using the grating word nigger, because we deserve better than that, and we don't have the right to, we can't internalize the degradation of the oppressor. Screw it out ourselves.
Jesse Jackson using the N-word. It was recorded the same day he made disparaging remarks about Barack Obama, although it was not used in reference to Obama.
We are watching in the light.
In the past 30 days, I've been called a n- more than any time in my entire life.
60?
What'd you say?
I said 60 was not that long ago, and you will never be like the upper class white man. You will never be accepted, you will never get that job, and you will always be looked at as a nigger.
Be a nigga for life.
I'm a nigga, he's a nigga, she's a nigga, we some niggas, wouldn't you like to be a nigga too?
You know, we call ourselves everything under the sun, but what we need to be calling ourselves. We need to be calling ourselves, you know, we call ourselves, we went from being niggers when we first got here to Negroes, from Negroes to color, from color to black to African American, and now in this new millennium, they might as well call themselves Obamians or whatever, make up some new title, make up some new mockery, some new byword, some new proverb to call ourselves. But to answer your question as a whole, it's done it's done a very bad thing, because we are the only people on the face of the earth who don't have identities. And I mean, take our Puerto Rican brothers and sisters too. Puerto Rican is not a nationality. It translates to rich port. These people knew our heritage. That's how they know where to come and get us. You know, so I mean, it's done a number on us, but it's done the will of Yah. That's the most important thing. And it is only when we come back to Yah and to doing the will of Yah 100%, that's when these curses will be lifted, and that's when our true identity will be restored to us. And hey, hallelujah.
One major point to note about Deuteronomy 28:37 is Yah clearly says we shall become a byword, or we shall become niggers, coons, horse monkeys. Psalms 44:13, thou makest us a reproach to our neighbor, a scorn and derision to them that are round about us. Psalms 44:14, thou makest us a byword, niggers, coons, among the heathen, a shaking of the head among the people. Look at our behavior today. We have become an outright embarrassment to ourselves and our Father Yah. Our shameful ways make other nations look down upon us in disgust.
I don't want any trouble. Just get out.
Can't stand, John.
I feel sorry for your mother.
Andy was going for the fence all the way.
What'd you say about my mama?
Deuteronomy chapter 28:68. And Yah shall bring thee into Egypt again with ships, by the way whereof I spake unto thee, that thou shalt see it no more again. And there ye shall be sold unto your enemies for bondmen and bondwomen, and no man shall buy you.
In Deuteronomy 28:68, Egypt is synonymous with oppression, slavery, captivity, and affliction. In Scripture, Egypt is referred to as the house of bondage, the iron furnace of affliction. Egypt was the symbol of hard, severe bondage to the Hebrews. What this verse is saying is this: the children of Israel will go into an Egypt-like, oppressive, powerful, severe slavery in ships. This is exactly how we got to the Americas. We were taken captive from the west coast of Africa and brought to the Americas in the bottom of slave ships. Once we arrived in the west, we were placed on an auction block and sold to the highest bidder. This process happened for over 300 years. This is a historical fact that can't be denied.
Oh, now see, we have come to it. Deuteronomy 28:68 in the book of Deuteronomy is the last verse in this chapter, and Yah just ties up everything that he has presented in this chapter of Deuteronomy 28, and he ends it by saying, I'm going to send y'all into slavery. If you are disobedient to me, I'm going to send y'all into slavery in ships, and you're going to be sold unto your enemies for male and female slave, and no one will redeem you. Now that's what it means in Deuteronomy 28:68 when it says no one shall buy you. That buy is talking about, it's speaking about redemption, because Because in the book of Leviticus chapter 25, it states that if we are taken into captivity, that one of our next of kin can come and buy us out of that bondage, buy us out of that servitude. So Yah is breaking it down in Deuteronomy 28:68. He's saying, listen, your next of kin, nobody is going to be able to buy you out of this condition, because it is by the hand of Yah, because of our disobedience, because of our breaking of the covenant, that Yah has put us in this tragic situation. So we look to history. What other people? Let's just cut it off to the Western Hemisphere. What group of people in the Western Hemisphere, what other people other than the so-called blacks, have been brought here in the hulls of slave ships and sold on auction blocks as slaves?
Isaiah chapter 51, verses 20. Thy sons have fainted. They lie at the head of all streets as a wild bull in a net. They are full of fury of Yah, the rebuke of your Almighty.
Isaiah 51:20. The beautiful thing about this scripture is, as it is broken down, the so-called African American would have no problem understanding how this particular scripture fits to him in his history. Isaiah 51 speaks about our sons have fainted. They lie at the head of all the streets as a wild bull in a net. Now let's really look at this. Yah said our sons have fainted. What does it mean to faint? When you faint, that means that you fall unconscious. When you are unconscious, you have no idea of what's going on around you. You have no idea of what's taking place in your surroundings because you're unconscious. You have no conscience. So Yah is saying your sons are unconscious. They're spiritually unconscious. He said they lie at the head of all the streets. The head of all the streets today are referred to as corners. So he's saying that your sons are at the, they have fallen unconscious and they're hanging on the corners. He says, as a wild bull in the net. A wild bull in the net, if you've ever seen a rodeo and you've seen when the man rides on the back of the bull starts bucking, that's called buck wild. You put a net on a wild bull, it's going to start bucking like that, it's going to start going buck wild. So Father Yah broke this down and he would give it to you in your modern terminology. Israel, your sons are unconscious, spiritually unconscious. They have no idea what's going on around them. They're hanging on the corners as a wild bull in the net, in other words, going buck wild. When you go out into these corners, brothers and sisters, you understand that these corners are so dense, they're so wild, that you don't want to go walking past them, neither do you want to go riding past them. You go out on a hot summer night, it don't have to be hot, it can be cold, winter, spring, summer, fall, they are out on the corners, packed from night and day.
They don't have any idea of who they are. They have no idea about the covenant, and they have no idea about Yah, the Almighty. They have no consciousness of Yah.
Do y'all know who the children of Israel is?
No.
Y'all ever heard that?
No, we ain't into all that.
Y'all ain't never read the Bible or nothing? Who the children of Israel? Remember when Moses went up on Mount Sinai? Y'all remember that? They can't even get y'all attention. The women got y'all up.
That was for Israel, not for us. And I can show you in Ephesians 2:11-12 where it says that we wasn't even in that time. We wasn't there. That wasn't us. That wasn't us.
Deuteronomy chapter 28 verses 43 through 44. And the stranger that is within thee shall get up above thee very high, and thou shalt come down very low. He shall lend to thee, and thou shalt not lend to him. He shall be the head, and thou shalt be the tail.
The stranger in scripture always referred to any other nation other than the children of Israel.
In Deuteronomy 28, 43, and 44, it says, the stranger who sojourns among you, or who's in your community, you know, they will rise above you, and, you know, they will lend, and, you know, you will borrow. You'll have to go to them for your substance. And I myself, I can speak from experience, because, you know, I did 7 years in the United States military. I never had anything, nothing so much as a negative counseling statement. And when I got out of the military, I couldn't get a business loan to start my own business. And as a matter of fact, I got a $20,000 severance pay to get out of the military. So I had that plus a business plan and everything, and I still couldn't get it off the ground. So you tell me, does that mean that we're cursed, or does that mean that I just didn't have my I's dotted and my T's crossed?
I'd like to know, well, why did you choose Harlem as a place to set up your establishment here?
I've been here in Harlem for the past 20 years.
20 years? No, but I mean, when you initially came over here, why did you choose Harlem?
I like it.
You like it here? Do you live in Harlem?
No.
You don't live in Harlem? Where do you live?
I live in Long Island.
You live in Long Island? So you said you had this store here for 20 years? You said business is pretty good?
Yeah.
Why do you think business is good?
Because people are friendly.
People are friendly? So if you think if you put this store in like Manhattan or something like that, you think you would do just as good? Or you think you don't think you'd do good in Manhattan as you would in, here in Harlem? You think you're better off here? Why? Because we like to spend money, don't we? Yeah, that's right.
How you doing there, buddy?
Good, how are you, my man?
I'm doing all right.
JB's, my man.
JB's? Can you state your name?
My name is Tony.
Tony? Tony.
Yes, sir.
Did your name change when you arrived to America?
No, it's still the same.
It's still the same? Your name is Tony in the Middle East?
Yep.
Okay. Who patronizes you the most at this store?
Well, obviously black people, because we're in a black neighborhood here.
Because you're in a black neighborhood, huh?
Yes, sir.
So they spend most of their money with you?
Exactly.
Okay, that's all I need to know.
Loving it too.
You loving it? You loving that money from the Hebrews, huh?
Why not?
Okay.
Could you tell me, sir, who is your number one consumer in this beauty supply store?
We're located in San Bernardino. Have to say I've come here.
Okay. How long you guys been having this business? And
we've been at this location for.
Okay. How long you guys been having this business? And
we've been at this location for maybe over 15 years. We've been in San Bernardino, this community, for over 20 years.
Okay. Can you tell me your nationality, please?
I'm Korean.
Korean?
Yes.
Okay.
Hebrews spend 95% of our annual disposable income with businesses located within other communities. Of the 5% that remains within our communities, another 3% is spent with non-Hebrew-owned businesses. With only 2% of our annual disposable income remaining within our communities, it is difficult, if not impossible, for us to maintain a reasonable quality of life and become economically competitive.
Deuteronomy, chapter 28, verses 58 through 61. And if thou wilt not observe and do all the words of this law that are written in this book, that thou mayest fear this glorious and fearful name, Yah, then Yah will make thy plagues wonderful, and the plagues of thy seed, even great plagues, and a long continuance, and sore sickness, and long of continuance. Moreover, he will bring upon thee all diseases of Egypt, which thou wast afraid of, and they shall cleave unto thee. And also, every sickness and every plague which is not written in the book of this law, them will Yah bring upon thee until thou be destroyed.
AIDS and and Black America. A report just out says the epidemic is as bad in parts of the U.S. as it is in Africa. The Black AIDS Institute wants the government to do more to fight it. CNN medical correspondent Elizabeth Cohen is here now with more. Hi, Elizabeth.
Hi. You know, we've talked a lot on your show about how AIDS affects African Americans disproportionately, affects them more than affects other people in this country. This statistic really says a lot. 1 out of 8 Americans is African American. However, half of all people living with HIV in this country are African American. So you can see how disproportionate that is. Sickle cell disease affects 1 in every 375 African Americans.
Meet 13-year-old twins Vanessa and Valerie Sumner, their 15-year-old brother Victor, and their mother, Gloria Amarte. They all have sickle cell disease.
Nationwide, 37% of African American women have high blood pressure and are 85% more likely than white women to have diabetes, one of the leading risk factors for heart disease.
Twice as sick as white people. They are. Pick 15 diseases, okay? 8 of them we get more than white people do. We just do.
Isaiah chapter 42 verses 22.
Right here, right now.
But this is a people robbed and spoiled. They are all of them snared in holes, and they are hid in prison houses. They are for a prey, and none delivereth for a spoil, and none saith, restore.
So that is our fate from the start. Trust y'all never make mistakes. Let captain to the Allison. So the 50 states listen. Just read Deuteronomy 28. Read it from the first verse down to the 68th.
If there's anybody out there that doesn't know somebody that's in captivity, incarcerated, that would amaze me. Because just about everybody I know has been on their way to, or they know somebody that's here. And definitely. So that curse is definitely physical. Being on the inside, I know firsthand, it's nothing but black and brown.
For black males in their 20s, 1 in 8 are in prison or jail on any given day. The U.S. imprisons Hebrew men at a rate 6 times greater than that of white men. In 5 states, Iowa, Vermont, New Jersey, Connecticut, and Wisconsin, Hebrews are incarcerated more than 10 times the rates of whites. Hebrew men make up less than 7% of the U.S. population, but comprise over half of the 2 million prisoners in the United States prisons. If the present rates continue, 2 out of every 3 Hebrew men will be in prison nationwide by the year 2020. Thank you.
What would you do to help eliminate inner city kids partake in violence?
That's a good question. The answer's a little long, so bear with me, because I don't think there's a silver bullet to this. We start with the President of the United States saying to America, we cannot build enough prisons to solve this problem. And the idea that we're just going to keep incarcerating, pretty soon we're not going to have a young African-American male population in America. They're all going to be in prison.
Are the majority of women in prison. In fact, they are the fastest growing prison population in the United States. Hebrew children are the majority of children in the juvenile detention centers. They are also the majority of children being tried as adults and sent to adult prisons.
Ezekiel chapter 16, verses 24 through 25. But thou hast also built unto thee an eminent place, and hast made thee an high place in every street. Thou hast built thy high place at the head of every way, and hast made thy beauty to be abhorred, and hast opened thy feet to everyone that passeth by, and multiplied by whoredoms.
What God expects from his seed here at the Greater Ebenezer New Revival Tree of Life Institution on Double Rock on the side of the road to Jericho Missionary Baptist Church.
Church been here, they persevere. How? Many churches on the block, how they get their profits. They sickle people in, then they cut their pockets. They ain't gonna stop it. You can't pay your bills, but pastors drive around.
I'm about to show you all the churches on Rogers Ave alone. Let's pay close attention. Church right here. Church right there. Church right there. You see that?
Wow.
Another one, Eureka, church right there. Another one right here.
Eureka, another church.
I can keep on going.
Got it. When I see him, I call him out. There's another one right there.
Another one right here.
Man.
And another one.
Wait, that's the Haitian one?
Yeah, there's another one right across. Another one right here.
They ready to get in.
Life is not true. This church is everywhere. Another one next door to it.
Right.
You're being joking, right? And I was telling y'all that. It's ridiculous, man. Look at this. This is Erasmus High School, right? This is going to be a church right when you pop up. You know, I'm about to make a right turn. I'm not even going out for that. I'm going to show you. Look right there. See that big building?
Whoa.
See that right there? That nice cream color of the church. Got him like.
And also, as me myself being a part of the Christian church before, what they do is they don't want you to ask questions.
Amen. Don't ask no questions. Don't ask how come why come the pastor have him a nice house? Why come the pastor got to have a nice car? Don't ask. I said don't ask. I said don't ask. Questions, just give the money.
Money!
some anointing. You put something up here. Woo! Put this anointing on it. I'll put this anointing on it. I tell you what, you put something up here. I'm put this anointing on this money, man. Woo! Put some money. Put some anointing on this money. You put something up here. You put. Prosper. Prosper, I said. Prosper. Give them the money, Lord. Send it to them. Glory to God. I place my anointing on this money. Your bills are paid.
Turn from these churches. Remove your foot from these houses of Satan. For these men are corrupt. They teach damnable heresy for filthy lucre's sake.
Isaiah chapter 3, verses 12. As for my people, children are their oppressors, and women rule over them. O my people, they which lead thee cause thee to error, and destroy the way of thy paths.
The women have become the rulers, and the children are oppressors. How are our children oppressors? First, our children are out here robbing the older folks. You know, when's the last time you seen a teenager help a woman across an old, you know, elderly lady across the street with some bags? I haven't seen that in, like, I don't know how long, just living here in the hood. You know what I'm saying? This is where I'm from. And it's no respect. They curse you out. They're not learning anything because they're being taught. I mean, you have babies having babies.
And they don't respect their parents. I have seen kids beating their parents, you know, rob the store. And these are young kids, 12, 13-year-old kids.
Deuteronomy chapter 28, verses 32. Thy sons and thy daughters shall be given unto another people, and thine eyes shall look and fail with longing for them alone. And there shall be no might in thy hand.
How can foreigners come to the United States and adopt our children so easily? Ann Kavanaugh joins us with more on a story with a special report on the forgotten children.
The United States has become one of the most popular countries for Canadians interested in foreign adoption. Judy and Martin Pitcher adopted 2.5-year-old Landon from an agency in Oak Park when he was less than a week old.
We just couldn't believe that it was so easy to adopt an African-American child from the United States.
Many say too easy. We don't have any national criteria for who can adopt our kids outside the U.S. We don't even keep track of how many babies are leaving.
We don't know who's being taken out, we don't know how many kids, and we don't know where they're going.
Pop star Madonna's contested adoption of a 1-year-old boy from Malawi has made headlines. In the U.S., the number of whites adopting black children is growing. A 1994 federal law now forbids racial discrimination in their placement. A rising number of those adopting are gay and lesbian, and not everyone in the black community is pleased.
You kind of have a blank slate, and they walk in the door, and we can say, this is what we need. These are the kids we have. Would you, could you? And they say yes.
this man and say, didn't have to be here. You didn't have to love for me.
Now, the United States is a land of plenty.
The world's richest country in absolute terms, but it has one of the worst infant death rates in the developed world, over 6 deaths per 1,000 births.
That statistic is double for black Americans, who suffer more than 13 infant deaths per 1,000 births.
From 1973 to 2004, nearly 30% of the so-called African-American population were raped through abortions. Out of the average, 4,400 babies dying daily that are reported abortions. It's an estimate 1,300 of so-called African Americans.
So this goes way back, and it's the same people. It's all the deception of state that we have been from that day to this day. Still the same number to kill off the Hebrew baby, and they just make it more high tech.
Adoption experts here say our forgotten children are African American.
According to the word of Yah, the role of a woman is to be a helper to her husband. That's the original reason that we were created from Adam's rib, if you will. So we're supposed to be there for our husbands, whatever he needs us to do. If that's cooking his meals, if that's cleaning the house, if that's taking care of the children, he's supposed to be able to trust in us.
The William Lynch letter affects the minds of Hebrew women. Well, first, the role reversals were switched. Through slavery, when you read, if you have read the William Lynch letter, you will see that they took our Hebrew men and made them weak in our faces. They made them weak in our faces.
The role reversal has done great numbers to our people. It has brought us down to an all-time low, because if you don't know your role as men and women, then how is the society is going to work? How is the house going to stand if you don't know the positions or the role in which you're supposed to play? Now, by the women not knowing our roles, it has made everything that much worse for the Hebrew people.
Feminism is taking away or subtracting from the male role. Feminism is taking over the male role. Feminism is reforming things so that the male is no longer needed. Feminism is little boys seeing strong women and wanting to be that.
The sons are looking at their mother as this authority figure because he does not have a father around. Whereas the daughters are looking at, this is how I'm supposed to be. So when a son is finally put in that situation, when he has a family, he doesn't know how to be a father.
We're raising a nation, if you will, a period in our life where the producing part of a family will be largely female as opposed to male. And that has tremendous implication, I think, for African American family.
5-year period, the number of businesses owned by black women jumped 75% compared to 29% for black men. And so it's no wonder that of $850 billion of spending power in the African American community, today black women control 62% of that.
There's another interesting statistic. 70% of this, I know, all the black women, hold on to your seats right now. All the black women, hold on, take a breath. 70% of African American women are single.
Thank you.
The so-called African-American and Latino leadership is destroying our way to Yah. They stand in the way of our true salvation. They teach us to worship the gods of our slave masters, Islam and Christianity. They teach us we are everything other than the people of the covenant, the descendants of the prophets. They tell you to be pro-black, and at the same time you have become more and more anti-Yah. They say the Bible is the white man's book, but this is the only book that speaks about your true history and heritage.
Us expecting any positive change from this ties in even more to the significance of us not understanding who we truly are. Because the scripture tells Israel that your leaders are greedy dogs and nothing. But see, since we don't understand that we're Israelites, we don't understand that this is talking to us.
Never elect our own leaders. It's like they're given to us. They basically just give us our leaders. You know, we got black mayors, we got black aldermen, we got black, you know, in all levels of government. But it seems they get in office and then they forget about the people, you know. It's like an inner circle of leaders. You know, we get the rally and rah-rah for them, but, you know, they don't really do nothing for us.
For me personally, man, it holds a big, man, it's a wonderful feeling. You know, I'm so excited about it that I can't even get the words out. I got like a million things that I want to say and how it makes me feel. So I'm just going to sum it up. Man, it's a beautiful thing. You know, it's wonderful. It's a wonderful feeling to know that there is change coming, you know, and a lot of people, they walk around with their heads down and their lips sticking out, and I really believe that there's going to be a lot of smiles on people's faces, you know, coming up in the next, you know, few months, few weeks, few years, and some good things that's going to happen. I just feel real good about it.
Certain duties by following the law and also by bringing the message to the rest of the nation of Israel so that we can come back together and then also bring the message to the rest of the nation. We are therefore being punished, for lack of a better way to put it. We are kind of being put on time out. We don't get to enjoy the things that we were as a nation supposed to enjoy.
The purchase match us. No other nation on the face of this earth can claim all those curses. They may claim one or two, but they can't claim all of them, especially one in particular. No one ever has lost their heritage but us. Not the Jews, not the Scots, not the British, nobody. And we also, we're always so quick to claim that I'm not religious, I'm not going to debate on religion. The Bible is not a religious book. You either believe or you don't believe it. Personally, I believe that it's true.
It's that time.
crimes that they're doing. We see all these things happening in our neighborhood, and it's like we have no power to change them. So how can you say that the curses do not affect us? Israel, you have to wake up. You are the children of Israel. And you have to understand, just like you raised your children out of love, that the Most High Yah put this cursing upon us out of love because of something that we did not do. He gave us the word, and we were supposed to bring this to the world, but we didn't. But what do we do as parents when our own children disobey us? We put a punishment upon them. So that's what the Most High Yah has done to us.
A change is coming to the house of Israel. Your sons stand on the corner. You have been taken into captivity in ships. You have been spread throughout the entire world into a worldwide captivity. Your women rule over you. Your children are being given to another people. You've been shown how your nearly 400-year history in the United States matches biblical prophecy 100%. You are the children of Israel. This is not about religion. This is about nationality. This is about a nation. The return of a nation to prominence.
Yes, yes, I'm on the run, and to be on the run is indeed no fun. Where is my place of safety? There has to be a way. I split 7 ways, they won't catch me today. Hot steps skip, they hot up on my trail. And if I stop to get a drink, I think I'll fail. I'm so thirsty, it hurts every time I try to yell. I try to yell. My name is Toby. I'm getting chased by cops and robbers and judges who appointed me a Jew, which lawyer? Word made me cap. capitalized the crooked letter. So I left it cause I didn't know no better. Oh, you didn't know there was more? You must not have read. Now curse shall I be in the city, and curse shall I be in the fields. Everyone knows but us. Why you think they want us all dead? Planned Parenthood, planned a children's funeral. Now it's up to numero uno to get ourselves together. MLK had a dream, but it won't from Yah, nor is Obama. Man can save you, yet you keep running from Israel. Hang behind the golden statues. Children oppress me. My wife tells me what to do, then goes off and screw another man. What the hell is happening? Mystery Babylon has given nearly 400 years of nothing but blood, sweat, and tears. Both claiming that I owe some kind of debt. I mean, money grows on trees, literally. I can't escape this. They still bear a straight fruit. Yeah, you Hebrews in the country know the deal.
It's a different point. Alright, what makes a person an Israelite? You got to be able to send it to Abraham. What makes a person a Gentile? Which means the nations, the northern nations, well, the Europeans.
It doesn't matter. It's all the chapter. In the end, I still feel like an ass. Ask me what I am, I say I'm black. Ask me what they are, they say they're English, German, French, Japanese, or Portuguese.
Make sure you
capitalize the peace. Curses are everywhere around me. Yeah, curses are everywhere around me. Like I said again.
Which is a lot of people that need help as far as
housing development and stuff. The money that they spent on that right there, they could have helped the people that is out here living in the streets. You know, I mean, a lot of times people when they show them, but it's also a lot of times the government causes for them to get it.
Liquor store, supermarket, and then a church. A liquor store in the same block the church is in.
There's another church right there next
door. Oh, right there on the top, yeah.
See, I tell you, it's too close to East 56. That's the church right there. So I'm right there.
This is Church Avenue. There's a reason why I call it Church Avenue.
You bought a
But then if you think about it, I mean, it's all in the scriptures, the same thing. It's all prophesied.
Never used to see.